Cape Elizabeth Planning Board meeting, May 21st, 1991. First order of business is to review the minutes of the previous meeting. The minutes of the previous meeting was as of April 16th, 1991. Are there any errors, omissions, changes, discussion? No. Do I hear a move to accept the minutes?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to accept the minutes as written. All those in favor, any discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? It's unanimous. And before we go on to the next order of business, we're missing one voting member, and Judith, Meichenberg and Judith. I'll appoint Judy Lardner as a voting member. Next order of business is the minutes of the May 7th, 1991 workshop. And the topics of discussion were shoreland zoning and wetlands, and road classifications. We typically don't take a vote just by consensus. We find them acceptable or changes. Any changes or revisions to be made?
No.
They will be accepted as written. Correspondence this evening is reasonably lengthy. In our packet of information, we have copies of the adopted sign ordinance. I advise all board members to place this in your thick packet of ordinances. There is a copy of the adopted health facility zone text change. And I believe the notation says included in zoning ordinance effective 5-8-91. Again, to be added to your zoning ordinance. Copy of daycare ordinance recommendation to the town council, which we acted on the 16th, I believe, of April. There's a letter from Jonesy's service station requesting a time extension in reference to the site plan approval of June 19, 1990, which expired on the 18th of May. There is, I received a letter, and I'll have Maureen copy it to planning board members, developers. It is a environmental planning guide text, which I certainly plan to get a copy myself, so don't lose that. It looks like an interesting text. A copy of a letter received April 21st from Michael Brown and Carol Brown in reference to the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision and their abutting property. Items of correspondence that were on our podium tonight, a letter from Parker Vanamy, M.D., in reference to the sleeper estate article on the agenda tonight, requesting a public hearing. A letter from numerous abutters and interested neighbors to the sleeper estate property, signed by numerous citizens and neighbors and abutters. With comment in reference to the public access waiver article on the agenda this evening. A note and a letter, handwritten letter of May 20, to myself and whomever else concerned, and that's the planning board, I'm sure, in reference to the sleeper estate public access waiver with strong objections to that application from a Lydia Vanamy Lewis of Ocean House Road, Old Ocean House Road, I'm sorry. That completes the correspondence. Before we start old business, I would ask if there are any other items of business, new business, that would be requested to be placed on the agenda this evening. Mr. Jones?
I wonder if my amendment for the extension could be considered this evening. I'm not sure if it's going to be on. I wonder if that's possible.
It's presently not an agenda item.
Is it possible to reconsider tonight?
I'll leave that up to the board members.
Critical factor for me.
It can be. Did you have a chance, hopefully had a chance to read Mr. Jones's letter? Is there any objection to adding that as a new business item following the proposed or the Schedule 910 article for public access waiver? We'll add that to the agenda. We do have a guideline that we don't take up new business after 10 o'clock. We'll hope to stay on schedule for you this evening. I will schedule that for excuse me, 9:30. First order under old business is Stonegate Phase 4, 17-lot subdivision located at the area of Stonegate Road and proposed by Stonegate Associates, letter requesting extension of period to submit for subdivision review, Section 16-2-4A. As I've done in the past, I've recused myself from voting due to a conflict of interest, and Vice Chair being absent this evening, I will appoint Janet McKay as the acting chair.
I note that Mr. Taylor is here this evening. Do any of the board members have any comment on the proposed motion for the board to consider? Do I hear a motion?
I have a motion. Be it ordered that the applications for preliminary subdivision review wetlands alteration permit under the pre-590 provisions and a permit for construction in a resource protection district under the pre-590 provisions for Stonegate Phase 4, a 17-lot major subdivision proposed by Stonegate Associates Incorporated and located off Stonegate Road be tabled to the regular July 1991 Planning Board meeting with a mutual agreement of both the applicant and the Planning Board.
Mr. Parker seconded. Any discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you, Mr. Taylor. We'll see you in July or before.
Thank you, Janet. I seldom watch any of the footage of the replays of these, but I did the last meeting for a short time. And during some of that discussion, the audio was not real clear. And I'd just ask the planning board members to try to remember to turn on your mics, keep them fairly close to wherever you're speaking from. Don't tap the microphone, that blows people's ears off. And just try to remember to keep them on. Second order of business this evening, the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision request by Peter Kennedy of Greater Portland Development Group for a 20-lot subdivision located in the vicinity of Channelview Road, Hunts Point Road Extension, Two Lights Road, final subdivision review, Section 16-2-4.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, due to a bias, I have to excuse myself from this discussion.
Certainly, Ms. Parkhurst. Judy Lardner has already been appointed as a voting member. Both Mr. Eichenberg and Judith Kane are absent, so we will proceed on this article with four voting members. I'd ask that the applicant, if he chooses, or a representative of the applicant, address the planning board. Try to limit your comments to 15 minutes or less.
Chairman Paul Frinsco, on behalf of the applicant, I guarantee you I can limit my comments to less than 15 minutes.
Good evening. I just happened to notice that in some of our meeting guidelines that I should state that.
There's an old saying about good things must come to an end. My belief is that all of the applicable concerns that were expressed by the planning board at the last meeting have been addressed, and you have correspondence from the applicant, which was submitted to you under cover of May 3rd, 1991, together with, and I want to point out one thing on that. Paragraph 3 of the letter refers to the septic system placement for Lot 5 in Phase 1. Subsequent to the date of this letter, additional material was submitted to you, with the net result being that the plans you now have show what you requested for all lots in the subdivision. That is, no encroachment within or outside of the building envelope as shown in the plan, or anything. The elements which require review and approval by other than planning board members, the deed instruments which we propose to transfer have been reviewed. I have conferred with Mr. Hill on those deeds, and he's here this evening and can respond. The letter of credit in its final form has been submitted to you. I believe it's been reviewed by Mr. Hill. We discussed it. I know that Mr. McGovern has approved it. With that, Mr. Kennedy and I are here this evening to answer any remaining questions of the board.
Thank you very much. I would ask that planning board members certainly won't limit it to the discussion to the nine specific issues from the tabling at the last meeting, but I think just to give some sense of organization to how we go through this, we might direct it item by item, any questions that you might have. Are there any questions? We might as well start with the CMP easement. Any questions or discussion?
Mr. Chairman, I think probably the most expeditious way to go through this is just to hit the nine conditions quite quickly and just get on the record what our concerns are, if any, about them.
Okay.
The first was the CMP easement and the electrical cable being depicted on the plans. Maureen, we have no difficulty with that at this point.
The easement has been depicted as well as the electrical cable. Because it's a temporary easement, it's not going to be continued as part of the new subdivision. The easement is not shown on the plat to be recorded, which is something at this point that I would continue to recommend. It doesn't need to be shown.
There's a concern about the I guess, have we explored with CMP whether or not there's something that has to be removed? Is that?
There's an existing cable on the site, and at the last meeting, the applicant provided a letter from CMP stating that they were going to remove the cable as part of the development, and that there will be new underground utilities placed in the road as part of the construction of Phase 1.
Mr. Chairman, that's not quite complete. The
okay.
utility would prefer, as it's set forth in this letter, to leave the cable in place. Obviously, it would not be live, it would be disconnected. But because it's a buried cable underground, and goes through areas which you are particularly sensitive to, the utility proposes, and we would concur, depending on what you want, that it not be removed from the ground, because that means digging it up in place. It would be cut off and left buried and not used. And the service which would serve not only this development, but all of the Broad Cove area, would be relocated within the right-of-way. So the easement would be terminated at that point. Where there is no more easement, there's no need to show it on the plan.
Is there any problem with the town staff of leaving the cable in place?
The town engineer has actually recommended that as well, mm-hmm. in order to avoid any disturbance of the wetlands.
Any other questions, comments on that section? The second issue being the performance guarantee. Questions, comments, concerns?
None.
And then the third item, septic systems in the buffer areas. Any questions or comments?
No.
I'd like to thank the applicant for making those changes. That whole issue has been a long, drawn-out issue. What I reviewed in the information given was very clear. They were well done, and I appreciate the time taken for that improvement to the site plan. Number four, the preservation of the farmhouse. Any questions or comments?
No.
I'd just like to state on the record that on further thinking about that particular one, I, as one board member, don't have any further concerns about putting a restriction on the farmhouse per se.
But you don't have concerns about placing the restrictions?
I'm sorry, don't wish to place any
okay.
restrictions.
Any other comments, questions? Judy?
I would just echo that.
The issue of the Jordan Farm Road location. Questions, comments? Judy?
I have a question for Maureen. Is the intersection of Jordan Farm Road with Two Lights Road, that part of the road, basically what it was when the preliminary plans were approved? I'm not talking about where it runs through the wetlands and how that was shifted.
As far as I'm aware, yes, it's basically where it was before.
Thank you.
I had some questions of the applicant because in reading and rereading as much as I could find that was ever brought up on that item, the issue of brought up of substantive change to the plan, concern about going back to DEP. Is there any confirmation of that? What's that decision based upon? What constitutes, I guess, a significant change in your opinion?
In my opinion, the relocation of a proposed public road and its access and intersection to an existing public road is a change which would require the site location order is based specifically upon the plan submitted.
Hmm. Okay. This issue probably bothered me more than some. And last Sunday afternoon, I was back on the site again and walked back and forth. And, there appears to be a limited buffer area presently. And I take it the stakes that are now painted fluorescent orange, that's center line of the proposed road.
Proposed right-of-way.
Of the right. Well, that ought to probably most likely be the center of the proposed road. And I'm paced off the width of the road and how much buffer area there was, and then step back and take a look at if it were to be moved 10 or 15 feet to the north, I believe, or west. It's a tough choice of balancing the
it's a tough call,
encumbrance on or the influence on the property next door, and by shifting it that far, we're concerned about the significant visual impact of the Jordan farmhouse itself.
But your recording plat does. There's also, in addition to the road waterway, there's a drainage easement. That drainage easement has caused the elimination of one portion of that Jordan farmhouse building already. And to go any closer is a real problem. That is the problem that the applicant wrestled with for 2 years.
I guess in my own mind, it was a question of how much more buffer do you add to enhance the protection or prevent the infringement on another property, and how much do you move a road that causes impact, whether value or visual, to what we consider to be a historical farmhouse?
The engineer has submitted what, in his judgment, is the best result in terms of buffering by maintaining the existing mature trees and augmenting the plantings in that area to create as much buffer as possible. I am not an arborist or an engineer, so all I can tell you is what the applicant asked the engineer to do and what he represents to us he did in his submission to you for that additional buffering. The key is to maintain the existing mature trees that are there and then adding additional plantings, which in our judgment help to create what we believed would be an appropriate compromise to the dilemma that faced the board.
Are there any other questions, comments on the Jordan Farm Road location? Mr. Emery?
Yes. Where is that buffer shown, the engineer's proposal?
I don't know the plan number.
On the construction details,
C-301. Tom, it's in the center of the page toward the upper part of that central area.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments?
No.
Concerns? Any questions or comments on item number six, the deeds?
Nope.
Judy?
Tom?
Number seven, lot configurations. Questions?
Just add that I am comfortable now with the lot configurations based on the information we've received.
See other nods, so I'll go into number eight, the plan discrepancies. Any questions, comments? Judy?
Maureen, can I ask you right now what the recording plat is lacking now?
On discussion with the town attorney, we've decided that a more appropriate way to deal with this project in terms of phasing would be to record the entire subdivision with a note on the plat that no construction would be allowed beyond phase one until appropriate performance guarantees were submitted and approved. So the recording plats we have now that are broken down in phases would not be the ones that would be recorded. It would be the general site plan that we've been referring to. That recording plat still has some minor problems with it, but nothing that I think couldn't be adjusted by the applicant and then submitted to the board for signing. There's a note on that one that refers to Two Lights Road as Route 77. In phase two, there are lots 101 to 114 referenced when those lots don't exist. It's lot 1 to 12. It appears that the building footprints have been revised. Some of the building footprints had to be revised because of the additional changes the applicant has made for the septic system placement. So, for example, lot 5 in phase 1, the building envelope had to be changed. It appears that all those building envelopes have been revised.
Mm-hmm. So the issues, just to review, have to do with the labeling of Two Lights Road incorrectly as Route 77, the improper or the inaccurate reference to the lots in Phase 2 is 101 through 114, and a note indicating, is there a document that needs to be recorded at the approval of each phase, the letter of credit?
Maybe I'll turn this over to the town attorney at this point.
Mr. Chairman, yes. I believe what would be appropriate is, for example, if Phase 2A were the next phase to be developed, that the developer would bring in a letter of credit in an appropriate amount approved by the town manager and the wording of the letter of credit approved by the town attorney. Then the town manager could execute a certification that an appropriate letter of credit had been received for Phase 2A, and that would get recorded in the Registry of Deeds. So
the certification itself is the recorded document?
That's right.
Yep. There was no other review by the planning board at that point?
No further review would be necessary at that point.
Other questions? Number 9, reference to Plan C 100. Any questions, comments? Anything that I missed? Are there any other comments, questions? The questions that I had were answered in the short update by Mr. Prinsko. Any other questions?
Are there not two letters of credit in our packet, one signed by David T. Moulton and the other one by Mr. Blake?
There may well be. One transmittal letter may be signed, Mr. Moulton. Mr. Blake was on vacation for last submission.
The letter of transmittal is signed by Mr. Moulton. And
I see.
Mr. Emery, I think the draft of the letter of credit appeared in two different places in the packet, but to the best of my knowledge, it was the same draft.
Thank you.
Calling the town attorney, Tom Leahy.
Mr. Chairman, on the issue of the letter of credit, the reason I'm getting up instead of Mike Hill is that I traditionally have looked at those with the town manager. The only point I'd like to make, and I shared it with Maureen O'Meara today or recently, was that we had first asked that the schedule depict the work to be done, the cost of the work to be done, and a schedule for the work to be done. That way the town can track it from the time of approval till the time the letter expires. The work to be done and the cost is set forth, the time isn't. That's not a problem, other than my understanding would be that you would not be able to draw on a letter for the different aspects of the work until such time as it expires. It is about to be terminated. I can see Mr. Prinsko has a different view. He can express that. That was the only concern that we raised, that our letter of May 9th asked that be there. The problem we have had in the past, and I'm not saying what happened in single phase development, would be that the work is realistically not going to be done by the time of the letter of credit expiration, but the town has to wait until basically what appears to be impossible to get done isn't done, and then can call it. I think what the planning board could do is look at the type of work and be satisfied that 1 year from now is a sufficient time frame to determine whether work is done. If you feel that's sufficient, that's okay. Mr. Prinsko may want to add something, so I'm not saying it's not okay. I'm saying that we asked for a time schedule, the purpose of which would be to determine at different stages whether things were done and allow the letter of credit to be called, but were not done in that time frame. Right now, it's all at the end, so to speak. Mr. Frisco can address that if you wish.
Mr. Frisco?
Chairman, one of the problems of dealing with different people is I guess there's 10% of the people don't always get the message. I've been dealing with Mr. Hill and Mr. McGovern, and I didn't know Mr. Leahy was involved in the LC, or I would have called him directly. The letter of credit is drafted as our standard letter of credit for the suburban communities around Greater Portland, with the following provisions. All of the work covered by the letter of credit must be completed by a certain date. It was everyone's belief, including the town manager, that the best result would be to get, for the town, would be to get the work done as soon as possible. Thus, you'll see in the final draft of the letter of credit, which I can probably grab from Maureen's package faster than my own, that the work must be, if we look at the first page, third paragraph, the work must be completed on or before May 1, 1992.
That's the last sentence of that paragraph.
Yes, sir. The letter of credit does not expire until 30 days later, and that's over on the third page, letter of credit, paragraph small a. That gives the town 30 days to take whatever action it needs to call the letter of credit. That is, under our code, that's more than adequate time for the town to collect a letter of credit under any circumstances, irrespective of where the bank is located. That is the standard practice. Everyone believed that it was in the best interest of the town to get the work done as soon as possible. The applicant agreed to a May 1, 1992 date. You then have 30 days after that, if it's not done by that date, to call the letter of credit and collect the money before the letter of credit expires. It seemed unnecessary to extend the letter of credit out to the fall if, in fact, the work is going to be done by May 1.
I understand your point. I don't want to make this a debate, but it is. We do need legal counsel for the town.
Thanks, Chairman. I think we're talking about two different things. Mm-hmm. I'm not arguing about setting the date of May 1st, mm-hmm. however that was arrived at. What I'm saying is that if you look at the work to be done, it's not all going to be done on the last day. It's not all going to be done on the first day. There is divided into different categories, and with many developments, certain work comes before other work, and it is not inappropriate for you, if you know when certain work is to be done, with in a sufficient leeway, to have that set forth in a letter. The letter is almost phased. It indicates that this road work is done first, and then this other work is done later. And if nothing ever gets started before May 1st, you can do something before May 1st. I'm not quarreling with May 1st, 30 days after May 1st to call it. I'm not quarreling with it at all. I'm just saying that the letter of credit you have, proposed to you, will allow the developer from today until May 1st to get the work done and can't be called unless the work is not done at that time. There's no interim points of time. There's no date by which the Jordan Farm Road work must be done, the access road, what have you. That's all. It isn't really technically a legal issue. It's one of your planning. Do you want those safeguards? In some letters that run for several years, I'm suggesting to you it is appropriate when certain things have to be done first, second, third, and fourth, that the town may want to call on a letter when it's very obvious that they're not going to get beyond the first phase. That's my point. And if the answer is this is a short time frame, it's 1 year, and you're satisfied with that, I'm satisfied. That's my point.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to hear from Mr. Kennedy just very briefly. I don't want to drag this out either, but was Mr. Kennedy asked for a time schedule, and if so, why don't we have one?
I have not been asked for a time schedule as far as the different categories of the road building go. And I'm, to be honest with you, I don't know whether I'm going to start the two lights end, if I get approval, or the winding way end with the water line. The water line is probably the first thing to be done, and the most difficult and the most expensive. But I haven't really made up in my own mind which to commence first or exactly when.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Emery.
The whole issue of schedule is pretty academic without a starting time. It seems reasonable to me that the work could be completed within a year. It probably could be completed in much shorter time, but unless we know what the actual starting time is, May 1st doesn't mean anything. Would the applicant object to a condition of approval, or may I suggest a condition, or at least the applicant submitting with the plans when one receives the building permit a probable construction schedule?
That's no problem, Mr. Emery. What you don't want to do is be under a gun when contractors are out there bidding, as you well know.
Exactly.
But yes, clearly the first thing Mr. Kennedy is going to want from the contractor is a construction project schedule, and I'm sure he'd be willing to give a copy of it to the planner, the building inspector, whoever is appropriate, town manager.
Would that alleviate your concerns, Mr. Leahy?
We also have to coordinate with the utilities and the Public Works Department with respect to accessing public streets, so they have to be notified in advance, too.
I'm a little unclear as to the exact question. I can't give you a schedule because I don't have a contract with a contractor.
But when you get one, you
will. When I have a contract, I'd be glad to show it to the town.
I think that's important.
Any other comments, questions?
Lost my place.
Any other comments, questions on any other issues?
I'd like to clarify one more time with Maureen the phasing. You indicated that the plat we will be signing, if this is approved, is a plat for the overall subdivision. The phases then would be more or less automatically approved upon the submission of an approved irrevocable letter of credit. Is that correct?
Correct. And the motion you should be making would not be limited to phase one. It would be approval of the entire subdivision.
So the irrevocable letters of credit will be the only things stopping them from developing phases 2, 3, and 4. There will not be signing of additional plats or anything.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
I that's important to remember in the scope of any questions you might have. Any? Jenna, did you have a question?
I don't know if there's any further. I'd like to put a motion on
okay.
The floor to be considered. We can have further discussion if we need to.
Certainly.
My motion is as follows. Findings of fact would be that the applicant, Peter D. Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group Incorporated, proposes to develop a 20-lot subdivision known as the Highlands at Broad Cove. Two, that the subdivision plan received preliminary subdivision approval in May 1990 and now requires final subdivision approval. Three, a performance guarantee for improvements to the site has been performance guarantee for improvements to the site in phase one has been submitted and approved by the town manager and the town attorney, but has not been executed by the bank pursuant to section 16-2-4C7A. Fourth, timely construction of all phases of the subdivision will result in orderly development of the site and the protection of the public health, safety, and welfare in accordance with section 16-2-4E. Fifth, the most recent revisions to the plans are not all reflected in the recording plats in accordance with section 16-2-4C7B. And sixth, the subdivision generally complies with the requirements for final subdivision approval. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Peter D. Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group Incorporated for final subdivision approval of the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Channel View Road, Hunts Point Road Extension, Winding Way, and Two Lights Road, be granted in accordance with Section 16-2-4C of the subdivision ordinance, subject to the following conditions. First, that an executed irrevocable letter of credit in the amount of $281,000 for Phase 1 be submitted to the town manager and the town attorney within 30 days of the date of this approval and prior to the start of any construction on the site, in accordance with Section 16-2-4C7A. Second, that final subdivision approval of the remaining phases in the subdivision be granted, subject to the approval of the plats by the planning board, within 3 years. Well, now this needs to be changed.
Right.
Sorry. Actually, that can be deleted entirely. The second and last condition in this motion would be that the recording plats and other plans be revised to reflect the changes in labeling and other necessary revisions to the development plans in accordance with Section 16-2-4C7B. End of motion.
Thank you. It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Seconded by Judy Lardner. Is there any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Emery?
excuse me, back to point number two. Is there indeed any schedule outside window within which the entire subdivision has to be completed from either the DEP standpoint or the town ordinances?
I'm not aware of any requirement other than there's a requirement for how long you can have a letter of credit for, but there's no requirement on how quickly you complete a subdivision. That's usually taken care of by the town as part of a condition of approval. I'm not aware if there's the DEP has a five-year.
That's all.
I have a question. Go ahead, Judy.
No, I was going to suggest an amendment. So.
Okay. Question I have, Janet, could you read number two and number three again? I lost place where you were.
In the findings of the order.
In the order itself, number two.
There was no number three. It was simply that number two was the recording plats and other plans be revised to reflect the changes in labeling and any other necessary revisions to the development plans.
As the person making the motion, do you feel that the labeling and necessary revision should be listed? I can ask you, and I probably can ask Maureen, whether that needs to be specified as to the items that we mentioned tonight.
Wouldn't be a bad idea.
Okay. Do you think it should be?
You could either do it that way, or you could add a phrase such as in a form acceptable to the town attorney and the town planner. That's not as neat, but...
I'd like for it to be revised as, I mean, we're all going to have to sign it, so I think it should be all acceptable to the board.
Might I suggest a change in what reads, which was deleted, and number three is now two, reflect the changes in labeling of two, correction of Two Lights Road instead of Route 77, that the correct lot numbers be given in phases two, is it A through C? I'm sorry.
All lot numbers be corrected would be an easier way to say that.
Thank you. All lots be corrected. And I don't know what the correct verbiage is for a note to the plan for recording the certification letter of credit. Perhaps the planner can. I see frowns on our legal counsel's faces.
We agreed to that additional condition.
Okay.
Steve said probably no patient regarding phasing.
Okay. Proper notation.
Appropriate notation with respect to phasing.
Letter of credit.
Okay. Any other discussion, questions? Judy?
I would add two additional conditions, if I may. I would propose for condition number three, the applicant shall submit to the town planner a construction project schedule for public improvements prior to obtaining a building permit. And number four, the underground cable in the existing farm road shall be abandoned in place in order to avoid disturbing wetlands or rare plants.
Making the motion, are those acceptable to your motion?
They are.
To the second E? Oh, you're the second E. I guess they're acceptable to you. Any other discussion, additions, changes? Could perhaps our planner, don't want to put you on the spot, could you read back through just the motion number two, three, and four?
Okay. Number two is that the recording plats and other plans be revised to reflect changes in lifting of Two Lights Road instead of Route 77. That all lots, the lot numbering be corrected, and that a proper notation with respect to phasing be added to the plan. The next condition would be that the applicant shall submit a construction schedule to the town planner prior to the issuance of a building permit. And the third would be that the underground cable be abandoned in place to avoid disturbance of wetlands and rare plants.
Any further questions, comments? None appearing. We'll take a vote. All of those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote for approval. Thank you very much, Mr. Kennedy et al. I'm sorry. We do need to take up the issue of public access waivers on the sites. Before we go, do I hear a motion pertaining to the...
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would like to note for the board that the motion for approval of public access waivers is only for phase one, and a motion for the entire subdivision would probably be more appropriate. You could use the motion that was in the previous package from the April meeting, which I have in case anyone wants to borrow.
I think the motion E might raise their hand and ask for that. It would vary only in the lots listed.
It would vary in the lots listed and in the type of public access requested by lot.
Do I hear a motion? Starting with findings of fact. Number one.
Well, with that prompting. Yes, I suggest the following motion, starting with findings of fact for a public access waiver. One, Peter D. Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group, Inc. is seeking final subdivision approval for a 20-lot subdivision known as the Highlands, which final subdivision approval has just been granted. Paragraph number two, lots 4 and 5 in phase one, and lots 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 11, 12, and 13 in phase two of the Highland subdivision have insufficient frontage on or access to an accepted town road and require public access waivers under section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. Three, the proposed public access waiver roadway off of Channel View Road will serve lots 1, 12, and 13 of phase two. The design of the roadway meets standards 1 through 7 in section 19-4-2B. Four, lots 4 and 5 of phase one gain access through a town emergency access lane. Five, lots 2, 3, 6, 7, 11, 12, and 13 do not have the minimum 200-foot frontage required by the zoning ordinance. Six, the proposed public access waiver requests will not One, create hazardous traffic conditions. Two, impede provision of municipal services. Three, undermine the standards of street design in section 19-4-2B. Or four, nullify the intent and objectives of the comprehensive plan. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Peter D. Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group Incorporated for public access waivers for lots 4 and 5, Phase 1, and lots 1, 2, 3, 6, 7, 11, 12, and 13, Phase 2, located in the Highland Subdivision, be granted according to section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
I think just to the viewer's benefit, sitting at home, a lot of those access easements are for lots that front on cul-de-sacs, and it is just totally unnecessary to have what's required in the subdivision ordinance, the full width on a cul-de-sac. So it's not quite as onerous as it may sound. I have one question. In Phase 2, Lot 1 area, in the Lot 1, there's an 18-foot paved road and a proposed 30-foot access easement. The issue there of that being an easement versus a right-of-way is that the person who purchases Lot 1 would be responsible for paying taxes on that entire parcel if that were a right-of-way. Then it might be some other different arrangement for the person who owns Lot 1.
Not quite. An easement and a right-of-way are the same. The question is the ownership of it. Here, the ownership would remain with the landowner, and thus, to the extent that the town, Mr. Daigle, assess property encumbered by a right-of-way, yes, there would be, the assessment would be based upon whatever value that land within the right-of-way would have.
Okay.
I don't know what his practice is.
Any other questions? Seeing none, we'll take a vote. All those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. I want to thank the applicant very much. I charge the applicant with a great deal of care. This has been a very intricate piece of land you've dealt with. It's been a long, I think I'm the only surviving planning board member. Perhaps Alice was here when we first started. Alice and I were the only remaining survivors. Welcome to the Club of Survivors. It's a very intricate piece of land, and we'll all be watching it very closely, and I look forward to it being quite a contribution to the neighborhood. Thank you very much. I welcome Mr. Parkhurst back, and we'll keep Judy Lardner on as a voting member for the rest of the evening. The third order of business under old business is the Affordable Housing Ordinance, amendments to section 19-3-4. Section 19-3-12 of the zoning ordinance and new provisions requiring affordable housing and residential developments. Recommendation to the town council, section 19-4-9. And I would ask that our town planner just give us a very quick update and some guidance here as I'm shuffling through my papers.
Hopefully everyone has brought with them the report from last month's planning board meeting. The affordable housing ordinance amendments before you are based on two concepts. One is that affordable housing can be integrated into neighborhoods and that a mandatory requirement is being proposed here where 10% of all new subdivisions would be required to provide affordable housing. 10% in each new subdivision. Or alternately, there are also some new standards provided for in here so that some creative waiving or adjustments to our zoning ordinance may be allowed in order to allow a clustered development that was 100% affordable. The ordinance amendments before you have definitions in here of what's considered affordable housing, low income and moderate income. There are some reduced there are some increased density, reduced lot size provisions allowed to meet the standards of providing affordable housing. I guess what I'd like to do is open it up to questions.
Are there questions for our town planner, or questions or comments on the proposed ordinance? I'm still searching for my copy. Thank you. Any questions at all, comments? It's an item that we've covered for, I don't know, I think it's 2 years now, and it's taken us this long to bring it to the town council. Taking a great deal of care. It's an issue that takes a lot of care and a lot of work to propose an appropriate affordable housing ordinance.
I'd just like to say that I'm very pleased with the final form of it, and I'm looking forward to sending it to the council for their consideration.
Any other discussion?
I echo Judy's comments.
Do I hear a motion?
I did have a question on page 2, number 6. It says affordable housing lots/units shall be constructed concurrently with the remainder of the project. In developments where the applicant shall construct at least 50% of the units, the building permits for the first 50% of the units of the entire development shall include the affordable housing units. It seems to me that there is room in there for if someone is going to develop a project and sell off lots to different individual builders, it seems to leave the affordable housing units in limbo.
Maureen, you might address that.
There was that concern on behalf of the board that, and it has been a concern in other communities, that when you have a development and one or two lots are provided to be affordable, that they may never be built on. The intent of this was, if you have a developer who's building most of the buildings in the subdivision that's proposed, that they would also have to pull the building permits for those other lots. You're correct in that if a developer were to get a subdivision approved and then sell off the lots to different people, that there would be the possibility that those one or two affordable lots would not be built on. I would assume that the town at least would get some kind of instrument that would provide for the affordability of those lots, if not with a building on top of them, so that someone would still have an opportunity to come in and buy the lot at an affordable price.
Okay. This doesn't say that anywhere, though, does it?
There is a standard in here that talks about in reviewing whether or not a developer has met the requirement that affordable housing is provided, it's under number 4, page 2, the applicant shall establish restrictions, conditions, or other limitations as are necessary to preserve the availability of affordable lots or units for moderate income households. The assumption is that if a developer were not going to be building on all of the lots, that they would have to provide a mechanism for planning board and council review that would somehow still meet the intent of this ordinance.
I apparently don't have page 4.
It's number 4 on page 2.
Oh, I'm sorry. I said page 4.
Judy?
I'd like to propose a motion for consideration.
Mm-hmm.
Be it ordered that the Planning Board recommends to the Town Council the amendments to the Zoning Ordinance, Section 19.1.3 and Section 19-3-12, and the addition of Section 19-3-17 requiring affordable housing in all new subdivisions and providing incentives for affordable neighborhoods.
We have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
By seconded. That's a term. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, we'll take a vote. All those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, that's unanimous vote. The next order of business under old business is the Davis Wetlands Alteration Permit remand by the Superior Court to consider a request by Richard A. Davis to regrade an area off of Cottage Farms Road. Wetlands Alteration Permit, referring to a pre-May 1990 Wetlands Regulations. Excuse me. I would ask, we had copies of, it'll take me a while to pull this up. Documents and memos from the original application and a couple of letters currently or recently. I'd ask our town planner to summarize the current application.
The application before you is the result of a remand from the Superior Court regarding a request by Mr. Davis for a wetlands alteration permit. In preparing the application, I culled materials from previous submissions by Mr. Davis. The last time he appeared before the board was in July of last year. At that time, the motion made by the board was that Mr. Davis was not a pending application under the old wetlands ordinance and that he would have to come in and apply for a wetlands alteration permit under the new ordinance. Went to court. The judgment of the judgment was that the planning board should review this under the pre-590, that is the old wetlands regulations, to determine the need for a wetlands alteration permit. I guess at any point I can turn this over to the town attorney who can give you some more background on it. The material you have before you tonight includes old material submitted by Mr. Davis as well as a new site plan that depicts the area he currently owns. There are two possible options for the board tonight. One would be for the board to determine that the area that Mr. Davis proposes to regrade is not a wetland. Therefore, a wetlands alteration permit is not needed as long as he conducts activities outside of the wetland area, which is indicated as hydric soil on your site plan, that no permit would be needed. The second alternative would be for the board to continue with a wetlands alteration permit process. That would be to determine that Mr. Davis does need a permit and to continue to review his application under the old wetlands regulations. Those regulations require that a public hearing be held. If that is the choice of the board, a public hearing could be scheduled for the next regular meeting of the board.
I beg the apology. The applicant, typically I ask the applicant to come to the podium at the very beginning, and I'm sorry I skipped over that. I believe Mr. Davis is here this evening. If you'd care to come to the podium and identify yourself and a brief discussion of the application.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Richard A. Davis. I own this land on Cottage Farms Road, and I've originally purchased the land with another party named Philip Willard, and we purchased the land 6-7 years ago, and a couple years ago I purchased Mr. Willard's half interest in the land and proceeded to try to level some land which was all filled land and had been filled, you know, over a period of probably 30 or 40 years. And what had happened, for the benefit of the new members of the board, and this case has been here a couple years now, I think, and the previous owner and owners had dumped a lot of piles of gravel and other material on this land, and as a result there were probably 300 or more piles, and trees would grow out of them, there'd be water in between them, and it was almost impossible to walk across the land. So my objective was to level these piles It was to landscape the land. It was to beautify the land. I was going to plant rye in the land. At one time, I even thought about harvesting the rye, but so much has transpired, and my plans have changed, and I have no intention of doing that now. There was never any intention to put any fill on this land. I never have put any fill on this land. There never was any intention to grade or to fill any wetland. No wetland ever has been filled on this land. I think it probably would be much easier, as far as I'm concerned, and I think as far as the board's concerned, if you could make the determination suggested first by the town planner, namely that this land under the old wetlands ordinance is not wetland, as evidenced by the material that I have submitted by Albert Frick, and there is other material which has not been submitted by the town soil scientist who worked in conjunction with Mr. Frick in taking tests out there and determining that the land that I want to grade is not in fact wetland. The plan that you have, I have a colored copy for, and I'd like to hang it up here if it's possible. I don't see any tacks or anything. I don't know how you hang a plan like this up. Do you have any scotch tape?
Just have to know how to drive one of those rigs, Mr. Davis, that's all.
I beg your pardon?
I say you just have to know how to drive one of those rigs to get it turned around.
I didn't know it had two sides. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Put this up so everyone can see it except the public. Can you see that all right, like that? The red at the top here is the southerly side of the land. That's the end of the paved section of Elmwood Road. And the red here is Cottage Farms Road, and the red here is Woodland Road. Since I've owned this land with Mr. Willard and by myself, three pieces of land have been sold. There's one piece in this corner right here, which was sold by Mr. Willard and myself over 5 years ago. There's a piece here which I've marked with an X, which I gave to my son, Alan Davis, last summer. It was a gift from myself to my son. And to the left of that, there's another parcel which jogs out here, which I sold last summer to a couple named Whit Wickey. All three of these lots now have homes on them. Two of them are occupied. I don't believe the one that I sold to my son and he subsequently sold has been occupied. The yellow.
Excuse me, Mr. Davis. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but in the plan it also shows that Richard A. Davis owns a property to the south west of the Matusek land. Is
right.
That also, was that originally part of this parcel?
No, it wasn't.
Separate parcel?
Yes. I've owned for about 20 years with Mr. Willard all of the land from this point all the way to Mitchell Road, but it has nothing to do with this application. Now, I submitted a plan some time ago, and at the suggestion of the former town planner, a colored plan. And I've corresponded the colors here the same as the plan that I submitted, so you could refer to it if you haven't. The yellow that's shown here is the wetland. And the wetland that's been agreed upon, you know, I believe, as I understand it, by my soil scientist, Mr. Frick, and also by the soil scientist for the town. This is all clearly wetland. The black areas are, are not wetland. No fill has ever been put on those. They're not even, you know, an issue here as far as I can see. The orange area is all filled land. And presumably, years ago, a good part or maybe all of that, you know, was wetland, Sebago-type soil. But for many years, it's been filled land. Now, a couple of years ago, I went out there and I started leveling some of these piles. And the town objected to that activity, you know, without applying for a permit. And so during the last couple of years, I've been, you know, coming before the board and working with town officials and so forth so that I can complete what I started 2 years ago. A lot of leveling has already been done of these piles. Now, my objective now, if I obtain the permission of this board, is to have, and it requires heavy equipment to do this because of the way the piles were dumped in here, would be to go onto this land and to just smooth the land over. I'd like to grade it, you know, towards the wetland, towards the yellow area. And as I explained at a previous meeting of the board, I would grade it just gradually toward the wetland. And if you went out there now, you'd see some areas that are where it's very abrupt. I mean, wildlife probably wouldn't even nest or come up here because it's so abrupt. I mean, it's like maybe 6 or 8 feet high and goes down very steep, you know, to the wetland. And my plan was to grade it, you know, gradually at probably a 45 degree angle or something like that. And at a prior board meeting, one member of the board asked about, you know, how that would, you know, exactly how that would be done, you know, with the bulldozing. And I told him that that what they would do is back drag, you know, from the wetland back this way, you know, into the fill type land all over. So, I mean, that's basically, you know, what I wanted to do. And during the last 2 years, the area that I intended to grade has diminished. Probably 40% of it, or a third of it at least, is not even there anymore. But that's basically what I'd like to do, and I'd urge the board to do it under the old wetlands ordinance and do it without a permit, to just make the determination that this is not in fact wetland by virtue of the evidence I've submitted by my soil scientist and the town's own soil scientist. And if you wish, I'd be glad to go through that, but you have it all in front of you.
Thank you, Mr. Davis.
Thank you.
This matter is back to you on a remand, and I think Mr. Davis and the town planner has adequately given the history and the options to you. The only thing that I was not clear listening to Mr. Davis, I heard the grading. Is it still the proposal to plant rye or a similar type ground cover? So it's grading and ground cover. I think the town planner has asked, and you may just consider the issue of how do you, he's explained back grading of the land. I think she has once asked, how do you protect against the intrusion into the wetlands? Is there any precaution that should be taken? With that said, you know, I have always maintained that there are two ways the planning board can proceed. At the last time that this was presented to the planning board, we didn't get to it. It was determined that it be under the new ordinance, so we did not get to it. And getting to it here is whether you should simply say that regardless if it was mapped as a wetland, the evidence shows it was not a wetland, or more accurately, that it's been filled. And as such, the activity can proceed, being grading and planting, period, and indicate that you find it's not a present wetland, it's been filled. That fact has been shown by Mr. Frick and has not been contested by the town retained expert. The expert did not submit a report. He was engaged in connection with the litigation we had. It was his determination that this is filled. I mean, regardless of what may be underneath, it's filled. It no longer has the vegetative characteristics of a wetland. So I've always thought you could find it's not a wetland because it's filled, and that's what your experts say, and stop there. Allow him to, Mr. Davis, to leave and to do what he's proposed. If he was proposing something else, for example, if he was excavating 6 feet down and building an apartment building there, you may want to proceed further because at that point he may be below the fill and it may be a different issue. In other words, what he's proposing to do is on top of the fill. Alternatively, and I guess the reason why at one point some planning board members said, gee, Mr. Leahy, how can we do that? It just isn't there. There's no provision in the old ordinance that says we can make these determinations. I guess he has to go through from beginning to end. And I posited the question, well, if it's not a wetland, how are you going to regulate it? How are you going to find that the alteration meets the criteria for altering wetlands if it's not altering wetlands? It's kind of circuitous. And my recollection was that the last time this was addressed, I know there's a proposed motion to go to state that as option one has been presented by Maureen. In other words, if you find that the alteration is not an alteration of a wetland, then why go through the criteria? They don't make sense. They're not applicable. All I can say is the hang-up of one or two members a year or two ago was making that determination is not expressly provided for. And you have limited jurisdiction. I've seen, if you want any members laughing, it does seem a little redundant and you know, how I often wonder how you can deny the permit if you find it's not a wetland. So it seems to me that's a threshold question. So with the representation that what's proposed is grading and planting of rye, and with whatever you folks who are charged with regulating wetlands deemed to be appropriate to determine either from the applicant or the state as a condition in regard to how do you prevent erosion or, you know, unintentional infringement of the wetland. I think that's just simply an issue. It may not require anything but his representation. It may require a condition. I don't know. But that's it, and that's all that's before you on this application.
Thank you.
I'll be glad to answer any other questions.
Sir. Oh, I'm sorry, not a Mr. Well, let me ask Mr. Leahy. I could also ask our town planner, but there are several issues that seem to arise here. It's my understanding that we're only dealing with the issue of whether or not the applicant requires a wetland alteration permit. Assuming that he may not, assuming that he then proposes to go out and plant more structural ryegrass, is there a provision in our ordinance because of the area of disturbance that would require that he somehow get a permit for either moving soil, filling land, or for, in fact, a site plan review permit?
I don't know of any. I defer to Maureen, maybe works with the ordinance a little more closely on that level, but I don't think there's a separate application or permit required.
If it was not considered a wetland, would he need an application for any other type of regrading?
That's right.
Correct. He would not need it.
Okay.
If it was not considered wetland, he could regrade, he could cut trees, any of those things could be done.
Regardless of the area of soil to be disturbed?
Correct.
The only other issue is the subdivision issue, but I think that's a separate issue.
It is a separate issue. We have discussed that issue with the town. Mr. Davis has referred to a certain number of lots that have been sold. It's a legal question of whether or not that would constitute a subdivision. The issue is one of proving intent and whether the town has or will in the future determine to use its resources to pursue that issue and seek a determination that it was a subdivision that was created. Truly believe that's a separate issue. The proposed activity here does not relate to those lots and issue.
And I don't want to lead into that, but sort of, in the question that the other two parcels, the L parcels, that you're looking and Alan Davis on to another party. If those parcels were to come before us for a wetlands alteration permit, would they be under the new wetlands ordinance?
Yes. My understanding is that the application before you has been amended to withdraw therefrom those area, that area comprised of those lots. So they are not in your application. Should someone want to alter those wetlands, they would go to the present ordinance to determine whether they can or they cannot.
Any other questions, Mr. Leahy, or any questions in general?
Is it my understanding that those lots have already been altered?
I know there are houses constructed thereon. I do not know.
There have been building permits issued on those lots. Other than construction activity, there has not been any additional grading of those lots.
Well, I'm hearing that they're grandfathered. There has always been a provision of altering a certain amount of wetland on anyone's lot without requiring a permit. It was only over a certain number of square feet which required a permit. So, as I'm understanding here, perhaps any amount involved in connection with the houses did not exceed that amount. I was not asked an opinion on that by the code enforcement officer. I assume when he gave the building permit, he reviewed what the disturbance area would be and determined that they would not require a wetlands permit in each case. That should have been a determination made on issuing those building permits. Whether the applications for those permits were under the old, new, I don't know. I can't tell you today, but I know that that determination should have been made as a separate, distinct determination for those lot owners.
Thank you. I'm assuming we will have an opportunity to make other comments, general comments regarding the application.
Well, I have a question for Mr. Davis. Question dealing with access to the land for the mentioned having seen it and access over Elmwood Road takes over a small piece of wetlands from Forest Road, takes it through wetlands from your other parcel through wetlands, and then you have a high steep slope area. How do you propose to access that property?
Well, as far as this parcel is concerned, it would be from Elmwood. I don't see any problem there. The area, I believe, that you mentioned, this small piece of wetland, is actually a little brook that runs down through there, and there's a culvert there, and it ends up down in some kind of storm drain down here. I have no intention of coming through Elmwood, and there's too many problems there. But there's plenty of room. If you study these contours, there's plenty of room to come up beside the lot, which I conveyed to my son, right along here. It's you know, easy access there. When they went in before, they went in through my son's lot, you know, in this area right here, but it's no problem to move in there. As far as the subdivision issue is concerned, I think that's an issue that came up fairly recent, although I heard some rumblings about it last summer. But I think this board would be well advised to leave that as a legal issue, and if I have to deal with that, I'd be glad to do it with the town at any time. I think it's interesting to note, though, that the title to the Witwicky land was examined and approved by Donald Philbrick, whom I consider, you know, an eminent title examiner in this state, and also the former town attorney for the town of Cape Elizabeth. And there's been title insurance on these lots, and that whole issue has been reviewed. And I think whenever a situation like this happens, I mean, some people may raise an eyebrow, they might have a question about it, but one point that I never have mentioned to Mr. Leahy or the town, because frankly I hadn't even thought about it, but when I sold this lot right here, I tried to sell all of the land last summer. all the land that I owned, and I was unsuccessful, and so I ended up selling this one lot. And there was pressure to do this because of changes in the wetlands ordinance and, you know, other problems. But clearly, if I had sold all of the land, and it was offered to the public, and it was advertised, and if I had sold all of it, there'd absolutely be no question at all about any subdivision here. And over a year ago, I talked with town officials about when I could make a separate conveyance without conveying all of the land. And I advised them of the date of the transfer here. I think the deed was dated maybe November 5th, but the actual transfer didn't take place until 2 or 3 weeks later. So it was all done, you know, in close communication with the town. And I don't have any trouble with that at all, and I'll be glad to go over it with town officials and Mr. Leahy or anyone else. But I don't see where it affects this at all, and you're a planning board. I think you're better to leave that to someone else.
Any other questions or discussion? Mr. Emery?
I'll be very blunt. I smell a rat. And I say that because we don't have the privilege of having a plan before us that shows any of your motivations in terms of grading your plans for subdividing the property. And I'll only say that either you're very shrewd in what you've done, and I congratulate you in the success of doing it, or in fact there is perhaps a legal issue here regarding the subdivision. I also can understand you as a landowner wanting to go out and bulldoze your own property and merrily do that, and be surprised when someone draws you into town hall and says, wait a minute, you're filling a wetland. But I look at the plan in front of us, and I hear things about a 45-degree angle. In our experience, and I'm sure most of the applications that come before this board, if we proposed a 45-degree angle next to a wetland, we'd be in a lot of trouble with the Soil Conservation Service and local officials. And certainly the same thing holds true working heavy equipment near a drainage course. I haven't inspected that drainage course. It could be a brook. I don't see any of those as being issues tonight, but I am extremely sensitive to the issue of a subdivision and more sensitive to the issue of your motivations in what you call moving some dirt and planting some rye. If you're successful in this subdivision, I congratulate you. On the other hand, if the town wishes to pursue this issue, we'll look forward to an application. That's my only comment.
May I respond to that?
Certainly.
Is there any specific question that you would like to ask me about?
Well, I'd like to ask you how you propose
instead
to...
Instead of making a generalized statement like you just made...
I'd like to ask you how do you propose to keep silt out of the wetland.
Because many times when people make a statement like that, it's due to the fact that they don't really understand what's going on. Well, now, if you have a specific question, I'd be glad to answer.
Okay, let me ask you a specific...
But I reject that kind of a characterization.
Let me ask you a specific question. How do you propose to stabilize the embankment that you're going to back drag at a 45-degree angle and prevent silt from eroding into the adjacent wetland?
I don't propose to stabilize it. At the present time, the angle in some places is almost directly up and down right now. My proposal is to beautify this land and to landscape it.
Well, I heard that a year ago, and all of a sudden there are two house lots on land that was going to be beautified and landscaped.
That's right. And during that time, the town enacted the new wetlands ordinance. And I'm a property owner, and I don't have to stand by and watch my land devaluate because the town drafts new ordinances. I have a right to protect my property like anyone else, and that's what I did.
I don't disagree with any of that. The only thing that I'm concerned with is I don't feel as though you've been completely upfront with this board in the presentations that you've made.
Well, I resent that statement, too, because I've been 100% upfront. And I'd like to know exactly what statement I've ever made that hasn't been upfront.
That you're only concerned with grading the hills to smooth it out so you can plant some rye and beautify it, within a very short period of time we find many housing lots being developed here.
Well, sir.
And not a plan that shows a regrading approach.
I've just explained to you the reason for that. If those lots had not been sold, the new wetlands ordinance would have prohibited maybe those buildings to be built at all. A person has a right to protect their property, what I did.
I don't disagree with that, and if you recall, I did congratulate you. As a prior attorney has said, we all have a right to agree to disagree.
You bet. And we have a right to do with our property as we see fit within the law, too. And that's
exactly
what I've done here.
That's the point, within the law.
And I don't like any suggestion that I haven't. and I've gone to court to prove my point.
No, I'm not suggesting that you haven't. I'm only suggesting that from your presentation and what you propose to do in terms of earth movement, I can tell you that the Soil Conservation Service does not allow that type of work as standard operating procedure for any developer, contractor that I'm familiar with.
Well, I can only tell you what I've been through with the planning board, with town officials, and in the court system. And I've complied with everything that's been requested of me. And if you will note, in the wetland area, at the request of the planning board or the town planner, I've forgotten who it was at this time, but there's dimensions all the way across here to the edge of the wetland. So that is well defined. There is absolutely no question where that wetland is. In fact, I'd submit that it's better defined than any wetland in the town of Cape Elizabeth.
No further comments.
Janet?
Mr. Davis, I think you can tell from the recent exchange that it is disturbing to have the question of a subdivision come up on the eve of. I know that the specific question before us is the wetlands alteration permit, and I believe that we are going to be voting on that this evening, but especially because we have two letters from Tom Leahy in our packet, I guess I really would like for you to just, if you can, in very brief order, since we have explored this issue to some extent, if you could apprise us of how you managed to write the second letter.
Well, could I say one thing about the letter?
By all means.
What you don't have is my letter.
I believe we do.
Yes,
that
we do.
As well.
You do? My letter to Mr. Leahy?
I have your letter to Mr. Leahy, hand-delivered on May the 15th. 1991. I've read that.
With respect to the subdivision?
Yes.
Okay. Because that was not in the packet that I received.
On the subdivision issue, when the conveyance or proposed conveyance by Mr. Davis to his son was being undertaken, I was contacted, and the question was whether that and the possible, let me back up. When this matter went back to court last time, there had been pending prior to that an application for a subdivision by Mr. Davis. So the sequence of events was an application for wetlands alteration, and then secondly, an application for a subdivision. The subdivision lots would have been two lots in this area plus the remaining lot, which would be a three-lot subdivision requiring your approval. Approximately a month before the wetlands alteration change, the new ordinance came into, was being adopted. It was a transfer from Mr. Davis to Arlen Davis, his son, as a gift. I understand that it was cited to be a gift, that the state of Maine transfer tax on the perjury was cited to be a gift. And so at that point in time, the question presented is whether that lot is a subdivision lot or an exempt lot. It would be exempt if it was a gift to a relative, unless the intent of the gift was to avoid the objectives of the subdivision statute. At that point in time, it really was a non-issue because Mr. Davis owned the rest of the land, and whether or not that was a created lot or an exempt lot, it didn't matter. There was only one other lot, the rest. There were no boundaries upon the adjacent lot. So when we initially reviewed it then, we said, you know, we don't have evidence of it, of any intent that is not be a gift and any intent that it be for the purpose of avoiding the objectives of the statute. Furthermore, at this point in time, the matter might be planned, there is only two lots at most. In November of 1990, the boundaries around the adjoining lot were established when that was transferred. So that would be the first time that there could be a three-lot subdivision, in my opinion. We had the lot to the son, and now the boundaries are around the adjoining lot. And with what's left, there are three lots there, The question is it a three-lot subdivision requiring approval, or was the lot conveyed to Harlan Davis exempt? We weren't asked to look at it right at that time, in November. We weren't called by the code enforcement officer to take another look at it at that point in time, perhaps feeling that there was no evidence of intent to avoid the objectives of the statute earlier or whatnot. I don't know, but we weren't immediately contacted. So in any event, at some point, as this is coming back before you and on remand from the court, our office is advised that these are the facts. I set forth the chronology. The gentleman applies for subdivision, withdraws the subdivision application, conveys to his son. I understand the lots may have been marketed together, and then presumably Mr. Davis sold his lot and his son sold his lot to third parties, Whitkey and Valent, I believe, in about a six-month period of time after the conveyance to his son. Now, the issue is whether or not this town has sufficient evidence, now or in the future, of the intent of of Mr. Davis to avoid the objectives of the subdivision statute at the time he conveyed the lot to his son. Intent of another person requires looking into his head, perhaps determining from circumstantial evidence. There has been a recent change to the Maine statute, which upon review of that issue with Maine Municipal Association and others, I think, although it's not expressly, it doesn't expressly grandfather prior gifts, it is the consensus that I could determine that prior gifts were exempt. More specifically, the legislature changed effective in, I think it was May or July of 1990, this provision. And it says what it always said, that a transfer by gift to a party related by blood is exempt unless the intent is to avoid the objectives of the statute. The additional sentence says now that the person receiving that gift, that person's lot will not be exempt if he transfers it within 5 years. The legislature has now given us an objective basis for municipalities and planning boards and code enforcement officers to determine whether that lot is exempt or not. We still have the intent as a basis upon which to seek a determination that it is a subdivision lot requiring approval, but we also have an objective standard in addition that says a transfer within 5 years is deemed to, if you will, it's going to deem it to be a lot whatever the intent was. We're just going to have an ironclad rule on that issue. So there's really two issues. One is, from these various facts in the chronology I gave you, what are the inferences to be drawn? What evidence is it of Mr. Davis's intent? In weighing the inferences to be drawn, the reasonable inferences that can be drawn from that those series of facts and timing of events, and weighing the cost of proceeding, weighing the result if we were successful in having that determined, at this point in time, I have not recommended that the town proceed to seek a judicial determination that a subdivision was created. I have recommended that we not proceed at this point in time based upon the facts I know them. I have asked Mr. Davis if he wants to volunteer, that he can tell me anything he wants to tell me about his transfer surrounding the marketing and the later disposition of the lots. He has rested upon his right to say that I don't have to defend myself, that was a gift, and thereafter it doesn't matter. And I have, it's my legal position that thereafter does matter. It's a question of adding up the facts, and an inference can be drawn that it was not his intent. I think a fair person could draw another inference. With any case for prosecution of a land use issue or any prosecution of any sort, it's a question of weighing the facts against the law, the cost of proceeding, the result. And I'm simply saying that at this point in time, initially determination has been made that on facts known today, I'm not recommending that we pursue that issue. I could have given you this all in executive session. I think it's probably more appropriate to give it to you in public session. That's It's an issue. Whenever there's a conveyance by gift, there's going to be an issue, and one has to look at all the facts and decide whether the facts and the cost of proceeding justify that proceeding. And that's what we did in this case. We waited, and that was the conclusion at this point in time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Leahy.
Mr. Chairman, could I just comment on what Mr. Leahy said?
I think just briefly, sure.
All right. I'm going back to where I started from, that in my view, this issue of subdivision has nothing to do with my application before this board, absolutely nothing, and that it should be left between myself and the town. I think it's ludicrous that I should have to stand up before the board at this late date and defend a gift that I made to my son.
And that's exactly why I said a brief explanation.
And I have no intention.
I agree with you, and I agree with Mr.
And I have no intention of doing it. It's not the first gift I've made to my son in my lifetime. It will not be the last. The declaration of value that I signed, and which was filed with the state and with this town, explained that it was a gift from father to son. And I signed this, and my son signed it. Under the penalties as set forth in Title 36, et cetera, we swear or affirm we have each examined this return, and to the best of our knowledge and belief, it is true and correct. I stand on that. If people want to make suggestions and insinuations and other unfounded statements, I'm glad to deal with it. I would welcome the town bringing some kind of an action to determine if I made a bona fide gift to my son. I would welcome it. But I resent having to defend something like this in front of the board when I'm here on an entirely different matter that has nothing to do with it. Thank you.
Planning board simply asked the town council to describe how he came to his conclusion. That's what he did.
But you see, the problem, Mr. Chairman, is that the packet that you received contained a lot of information concerning a prior application that I had for a three-lot subdivision. It's not part of the application that I have before the board now. It has nothing to do with it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Other items of discussion, questions? I have a question, if I could, of Mr. Davis. And just in general, I was on the board at the time we decided the last time you were here, and it was an issue of whether we were dealing with it with a pre-May 1990 wetlands issue or a post-May 1990 wetlands ordinance. The determination by the court has been that we'll determine this by the pre-May 1990 wetlands ordinance. My question has to deal with the existing yellow area of wetlands, and if you can specifically identify how you intend to back drag a very steep slope. I was looking at your comments that from, and I don't remember the date because I've turned away from it, where you specifically said you intend to slope that abrupt slope. That's a real concern because the siltation into the wetlands is a concern of us as a planning board. I think that needs some real specific detailing from your point of view, how you plan to do that.
The bulldozer that started this work, it's a huge bulldozer. It cost $700 for one day. And the fact it was operated by a fellow that grew up in the town. And what would happen, as I understand it, he would just take the blade, the front of it, which it's huge, and would gradually start pulling back from the bank and slope the land. I don't know how else it could be done.
Mm-hmm.
If it became a major problem, I probably wouldn't do it at all. I mean, that goes against what I've tried to do here and what I want to complete.
I think that may be an alternative, not to approach the fringe of the wetland area within a certain
I think it would
area.
Be unfortunate.
That's your description was a fairly archaic method of
right.
sloping into a wetland. So.
But very practical. Some of this land, the fill, it has huge piees of concrete, granite.
I've been there.
You know, You've been on it?
Yes.
And I think, but anyone that would walk across that wetland area, I mean, they'd have to think that it would be much nicer if it were sloped, you know, to the wetland. In fact, everyone that I've ever been on the land was, you know, that's the way they felt. It's very, the way it is now is very artificial and hilly, and it's difficult to even walk.
Do you expect to bring topsoil in for seeding?
No, not necessary. In fact, during the last 2 years, the vegetation
is growing pretty well by itself.
It's so thick there that I don't think I'd even attempt this until, you know, after the fall, late fall. Difficult to even go in and see what you're doing there now in some areas. Mm-hmm. I'd rather do it when there's no vegetation there.
So is it going to require stripping the vegetation from that area now? Or just simply bulldozing it? I don't know.
That's all. That's all we did before.
I mean, I remember from our last discussion when you were previously before the board that the size of the trees and so forth, how long they had been growing and so forth. They have some sizable vegetation there.
They're probably 15 or 20 feet high. Mm-hmm. And some of them were growing at angles because they were growing out of these piles that were in there. Mm-hmm. In the last 2 years, there's some that are probably 5 or 6 feet high.
Any questions from other board members? Ms. Demery?
I guess I'm getting more confused as the discussion lingers on. It would seem to me that if Mr. Davis, if one of the findings is if this isn't a wetland, there's no application before us regarding grading or anything else. It's not clear to me if a determination is made that it's not a wetland, is there in fact a need for a wetland alteration permit? And if not, then why are there any discussions about grading activities and so forth? Those, I would think, would be handled with other sorts of permits.
I'd ask that our town planner respond.
The motion that's proposed before you is intended to make the finding that there is no proposed alteration in a wetland area. The two conditions that are attached to that motion are anticipated to further ensure that there will be no alteration of a wetland. If these one and two are followed, then there will not be any erosion into the abutting wetland, and a wetland alteration permit is not needed. So I recommended those as part of your determination that there is no alteration of a wetland.
But, in fact, how can there be an alteration of a wetland on a presumption that there may be an alteration? Doesn't he have to, in fact, alter the wetland before he then has to come back and go for a wetland alteration permit?
Mr. Emmer, if I can, this sounds vaguely familiar to the way it went around last time. I think what Maureen O'Meara is saying is that the proposed activity of grading and planting will not result in the alteration of a wetland. I mean, there's a sandwich theory that underneath this field is a wetland, and certain activity, if proposed, maybe alters that wetland. Or activity on this land may affect the adjacent wetlands that you're referring to in protection against an intrusion by way of silting or erosion of the wetland. So I think it's a fine line. I agree with you. It's a conceptual difficulty to say it's not a wetland, but we're giving a permit. I think that's why she crafted this option one in the fashion she did, by saying that if it is this proposed activity, and so long as it doesn't intrude into the wetland, it be permitted, and it does not require a separate permit. There just wasn't a provision. It would be nice if your old wetlands ordinance said one of the things you could do is determine that the map was wrong, it's a macro view of Cape Elizabeth, and at this particular site, it's not a wetland. Go away, applicant. I mean, that would have been a nice option for you. It simply doesn't say that, and that's why we've been fumbling a bit. Does he have to go through a public hearing? Do you have to have a site walk? You know, when you go through the criteria, if none of this activity is affecting the wetland, how do you judge it? Because, you know, the proposed activity under option one, you're concluding, doesn't affect the wetland. So that's, I hope I'm moving this ahead, not back, but that's why option one is presented the way it is.
I have a question while you're up at the podium, Mr. Leahy. And it has to do with the legal appropriateness and enforceability of any condition that we might make a motion saying that there is no wetlands permit required, and you can go ahead and do this on the conditions that you don't do this, you don't do that. is that appropriate legally for a planning board to make those conditions, and is it enforceable?
Well, I read the conditions as stating that there's no, that there shall be no construction activity, regrading activity, or erosion of soil beyond the hydric soil line depicted on the plan and or into the area labeled Sebago A. I think that if Mr. Davis proposes or in fact carries out activity which carries him into what's marked here in yellow into the hydric soils in Sebago A, he's got a problem because his activity is affecting those wetlands. I have no problem with your attaching this condition, none. The second, the applicant shall submit information depicting the slope ratio of the regraded land as it approaches the hydric soil. Once again, what you're saying is your map has depicted the boundary. Now, either someone mentioned maybe you could stay back a certain number of feet, and alternatively, if you're not staying back a certain number of feet, you can't go right to the edge because that presents a reasonable likelihood of an impact on that wetland. Show us how you're going to grade it, slope it. I submit that I think these are acceptable conditions for you to impose. I have no problem. I think we're next to a wetland, and we want to protect that adjacent wetland. And two, what's been determined is that this is filled land, and there's no vegetative characteristics to support a finding that it's a wetland today. Mm-hmm. You know, leaving that theoretical concern of, you know, if you lift it all off, what would you find underneath? But it's been filled for 20, 30, 40 years perhaps, and I think we concluded as a matter of our proceeding in court that it wasn't worth pursuing that issue if what was being requested is to grade and plant. And once again state that if he was digging a 12-foot excavation, it might be a different question because certain activity may put you into a wetland. That was never before the board because that's not before you with his requested activity. And his activity is to grade and plant.
Thank you. Judy?
I guess I want to make sure I understand it, maybe I don't. As I get the impression from this option one that the first part that we're proposing be ordered in essence says that the planning board has no jurisdiction over this application, and that's why I'm confused why we can say, but given that, we will attach conditions, especially since the first condition is almost restating the ordinance. If the gentleman does go into the wetlands, he's violated the code, he needs to come back before the board, get a wetlands alteration permit. Are we able to attach these conditions simply because the pre-May 90 ordinance is silent on how one deals with these situations? And since there's no express authority to say something is not a wetlands, we might also assume that if we make this assumption, we can attach these given conditions to ensure that the intent of the ordinance is carried out?
I think it's an attempt to deal with the fact that the ordinance is not clear what you do with. If you want to bypass the hearing and bypass a wetlands permit issue, you know, we're trying to reach a reasonable compromise. You know, we have a mapped wetland that's proposed to be altered, and the ordinance did not provide for how you deal with that.
Okay.
And I guess maybe I'd ask, with these two conditions that may be proposed, Mr. Davis, do you have an objection to a prohibition of activity beyond the hydric soil line, number one, and number two, that you'll submit information depicting the slope ratio as it approaches that line and erosion control measures that will prevent erosion or filling into the Sebago A? Do you have a problem with those two? If you don't, then I think this is a moot issue.
I don't have a problem with number one. I might have a problem with number two because I have no idea what I'm getting into there. I mean, to me, it seems quite clear what I wish to do. And if number one is in effect, that no fill shall be put in the wetland, to me, that should cover it. That should be the end of it. I really don't like that second condition because that involves a town engineer, it involves more plans, it might involve coming back to the planning board, it might
involve going beyond the planning board. It just opens up a lot of problems. And under option number one, I don't think the board has that power anyway. I don't think it's necessary, frankly. I mean, if number one applies, then I will not intrude on the wetland. That should cover it. But it's well delineated, and if I did, the town can take whatever action they feel necessary.
I guess that depends on the consensus or the expertise of the board members as what, how they see the treatment of an abrupt slope into and how, in a comparative basis, would handle that same issue on any piece of land. To say I guess I'll leave it at that. Any other questions?
Excuse me. Does include not only construction activity or grading activity in the Sebago area, but the third is no erosion of soil beyond that.
I just noticed that.
So it's there. I would suggest to you that two is supportive of no erosion. It is, tell us how you're going to prevent that erosion.
Mm-hmm.
I think Mr. Davis is afraid that if he says yes to two, he's back here either before the engineer or you reviewing how he proposes to do that. He's, I think, reluctant, perhaps the word, to do that. But I think all you're asking him is to tell us how. And if it's a back rating, there's some level of discomfort on your part. I don't have a problem with these. I think it's just it goes with preventing erosion into the Sebago area that clearly cannot be impacted by his activity.
Samory?
Mr. Chairman, although the applicant may not think that I would make this statement, I share some of Judy's concerns, and it almost seems to me as if this is being used as an implement to get around something that's missing in the ordinance, that is a site plan provision for grading practices or some other ordinance structure. And I have a lot of concern about someone coming in not requiring a permit and then conditions being placed on a permit that's not required. I think the conditions that are listed in the option would, once those conditions have been violated, it would be at that time that the wetland had been altered under the current, under the pre-590 definition. At that point, the issue could be brought before the board through some sort of an application process. But I personally have a lot of trouble placing conditions on an application, on a permit that isn't required.
Well, that was the point of my question, Mr. Leahy. Was it legally appropriate and enforceable? And I think he indicated to us that he would submit that they are, both of those.
Mr. Chairman, in order to move this along, I'd like to put
Certainly.
A motion before us, and then we
Thank
can
you.
Have whatever further discussion we might require. Motion is as follows. Findings of fact, one, that Mr. Richard Davis has submitted an application for a wetlands alteration permit for a lot located off Cottage Farms Road and Elmwood Road, which is mapped wetlands under the pre-May 1990 regulations. Two, the area to be regraded has been classified as filled or made land. Three, the area to be regraded will not alter a wetland as defined in the pre-May 1990 wetlands regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the planning board determines that the area owned by Richard Davis off Cottage Farms Road and Elmwood Road, upland of the hydric soil land, for the sole purpose of level, sloped, regrading, and planting of rye, is not a wetland under the pre-May 1990 wetlands regulations. No wetlands alteration permit is required as long as the following conditions are adhered to. One, there shall be no construction activity, regrading activity, or erosion of soil beyond the hydric soil line depicted on the plan and or into the area labeled Sebago A. Two, the applicant shall submit information depicting the slope ratio of the regraded land as it approaches the hydric soil line and erosion control measures that will prevent erosion into or filling of the Sebago A area to the town engineer for approval.
So we have a motion and a second. Is there further discussion? Mr. Emery?
Let me just for the record ask this question one more time. If there were no wetlands on this map in front of us, and the same area, well, I don't even know how much area is being proposed to be altered, maybe that's another issue, but would there be any other permits required by the applicant if it were just grading, reseeding, as described in the application?
I would suggest that there would be no other permits required. However, as part of the review, the board may have asked the applicant for additional information to make that final determination that there would be no impact on wetlands, such as erosion control measures, slope ratios, and other construction measures.
Okay. Any further questions? That makes it clear.
Any further questions, comments, discussion? Yeah, Judy?
I would just like to add for the applicant, at least my intention on voting for this is the second condition, I would view that as a way for you to consult with the town engineer, who I would like to think is an expert in these matters, to help you do this in a manner that will not encroach on the wetlands. And I hope ensure that you don't have to come back before us as a permit. I would like to view this as not a particularly onerous condition.
I'd just like to make a statement that, in a similar vein, that my support of the second condition is based on the fact that we're trying to prevent actions that were similar to the filling of wetlands, be it 20, 30 years ago, and we're simply asking that the treatment of the regrading is a contemporary good sense approach to any property that abuts or contains wetlands. Any other discussion? None appearing. We'll take a vote.
We haven't had a second yet,
yes,
I don't think.
Mr. Yes. Parker still seconded the motion. All of us in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote. Thank you, Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Do you want to sign a plan, the Mylar plan for this?
No. I don't think that's required.
Pardon?
It's not required for a site plan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next order of business this evening, under new business, high school playground relocation.